And then he said, he showed me an important scripture. He said, not only am I doing it so you'll mature, he said, I want you also to do it out of compassion and comfort. Mm-hmm. Jesus saw those lepers, and he had compassion on them. They said, Lord, have mercy on them. Mm-hmm. And he had compassion on them. Jesus said, the scripture said, that sometimes you go through trials mm-hmm. and tribulation, and you can say to your friend, I got a testimony. This is what God did to me. He said, just as I comfort you when you went through, you need to be a comfort to somebody else.
All right.
You know, I look at some of these young brothers. I know what you're going through. I know sometimes you want to throw children out the window, but I know. I understand. But it was someone said, love your children. They're a gift from God. It was someone that told me how to be a better mom. They comfort me through my hard time. I know some of you have lost job. Minister tells us she lost her job, and she now she can be a comfort to somebody that's lost the job. God ain't being mean to you. He just wants you to know, just as I got you through, I want you to help somebody else to get you. I don't want your foot to nail while I slip because you saw the prosperity of the wicked. I don't want you to turn back because you think you're the only one left. I want you to press forward from the heart of a higher calling. I want you to get that little experience to mature you. And not only do I want you to be a comfort, but he said, I want you to be complete. See, my brethren, get it all joy when you fall into diverse temptation, knowing that the trying of your faith worketh patience. But let patience have a perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire and wanting nothing. Y'all, I know we've been living. I know we go through the motion. Some days we just go through our routine. But can I let you in? Even part of your brain died, you can still do your routine. It wouldn't make sense to everybody else, but you can still do your routine. We got to go beyond that. We got to become the spiritual beings that God has called us to be. We got to be able to live. We got to count it all joy. I know it's exactly the same, but count it joy. I didn't like the things that happened, but I counted joy because I saw what he did for me in my life. And I know that I'm more complete. I don't cry at everything. I don't get offended at everything. I don't run like I don't fall down. I don't use drugs to get me through. I don't use sleep to get me through. I don't use all those other elements that you could use to get you through, because I know that I am complete in the Lord.
All right.
That's where he wants you to be. And so, what I got to ask, are you living? I know he healed you. I know he got you through. But are you whole?
Mm-hmm.
And so our scripture said a word about expectation. Reminds us that Christ wants us to gain personal experience. But it also points out that we've got to become equipped. He said, faithful in prayer. And sometimes, you know, it's just kind of hard to believe that we have everything we need. You know, I always say the Oz story. Dorothy was running around all over the Oz and having all them problems. And then the wizard at the end said, click your heels, Dorothy, you could have been there. You know, sometimes we need to have everything in life. We need to start clicking our heels. We need to know what we have. We need to know that when he gave us prayer, he opened up a door that can't be closed. We need to know that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. We need to know that there's a process to living. We're trying to walk it by ourselves. We get a little money, we can take it from here. Our children doing well today. Today, mind you, we can take it from here. Everything's falling in line today. We can walk it out. But can I tell you? He said, be faithful in prayer. You can't give up prayer. Just like the leper went back. He went back and he gave God some praise. He said, thank you, Lord. I thank you for what you did, Lord. I'm faithful. I want to be faithful to what you brought. You need to get that process. He said, you don't have to be careful anymore. You don't have to tip around. But the Bible said the devil's coming. Yeah, he's coming. He's coming. And he ain't never changed his agenda. He's the same yesterday, too. He came to kill, steal, and destroy. But can I tell you, be careful for nothing. Prayer and supplication. Thanksgiving. Just let your request be laid down. Already covered. You just forgot the process. Call on when you get up. You forgot that. Yeah. He said, now prayer is that great equalizer. I know you thought some of the old people had the prettiest prayers going, but can you hear what the leper said? Have mercy. You don't have to know no problem. You don't have to know nothing perfect. You just have to call on him that he is a provider. He said, anything that you ask in my name, he said, I'm going to give it to you. I know we've forgotten the promises that he made. Made so many promises to us, but we go through life so hard. We get healed, we make it through the day, we have all these elements, but can I tell you, we're not whole. We're not whole until we embrace Christ in our life. Not my will, but your will be done. Alright, when you pray, pray looking for an answer. Don't pray and walk away and think it's not God. He said be consistent, be faithful in prayer. How faithful is your prayer life? I know when things come, it get pretty strong there, but how faithful is it? Because I have the promise. The prayers of the righteous availeth much. And if you read your Bible, they said there are thousands of promises in there, and they all got your name on it. Because he doesn't have any respect of person. He doesn't make any differences among you. All you have to do is ask. And can I tell you, he knows where you live. He knows where you look Samaria in. I know you thought it was all bad out there, but he knew where you were. He knows what you're going through. He knows what you're going through physically, emotionally, spiritually. He knows the hairs on your head. He knows all about it. Why are y'all going to treat God like you can hold something back up? Can I tell you, he created you. He knew you when you were yet, before you were formed in your mother's womb. He knew you when you were bleeding and you did his life. Can I tell you, you're forgetting who you're serving. You're forgetting what the power of prayer. Why isn't it working? He said, ask and I'll give it to you. He said, I just want to give you things. And then we just walk on it. We live, we get healed, but we don't get whole. And then the letter for it said, our scripture says a word about expectation. It tells us about gaining personal experience. Reminds us that we are equipped. But I want to close by reinforcing the fact. This is from Brother Bozeman, Pastor Bozeman, Minister Bozeman. Been empowered to live. Do you realize that we've been empowered to live? And you know, Satan's strategy has always been the same. If he can take you home, he can afflict you with tribulation, and he can distract you from prayer. That's what he even did it with the apostles. He just took their hope. Ain't nothing gonna happen. What can I do? Afflicted them like he did with Job. Oh, his body is hurting with physical. And then he distracted them. Elijah said, I'm the only one left from the prayer. But can I tell you? The scripture tells me, rejoice in hope. Faithful in tribulation. Patient in tribulation. And faithful in prayer. My friends, my fellow Christian, there comes a point where you got to make a choice.
Amen.
You've got to choose. You've got to choose to take back your life. Are you happy with where you are? Are you just barely getting by? Do you want to stay where you are and in the land of want, need, distress, disgust, dissatisfaction? And we serve a God that made everything. And you have a choice of the bad or the good, and yet you're selling for something, I don't know, in between. You hear what Preston said, when you go out to eat, you and your husband might want to eat. I want to eat Chinese, I want to eat Mexican. And then you say, well, let's go eat American because it'll make both of us happy. No, somebody ought to be happy. Somebody ought to be Chinese, and somebody ought to be eating Mexican. But ain't nobody ought to be eating American if neither one of you don't want it. That's the way we do God. But when we sell it for something on either end, it is not anything that either of us really want. But I serve a God that said that you have that choice. Just as that leopard hollered out to him. And I'm sure he didn't know if Jesus was going to respond. But the only hope we have is in Christ Jesus. They hollered out to him. And when they hollered out, can I tell you what he did? He covered them with his grace and his mercy. You know, it says, the good thing, be of good cheer. You're going to have trials and you're going to have tribulations in this world. But the good part, you know where the happy part come in? The happy dance come in because Jesus says, I have overcome the world. And what's left? He's overcome the world. So what can the world give you that he doesn't already know about? What can the world lay in front of you that you can't walk on it? I know we talk about stomping the devil. Let's just stomp it on out. Let's just walk it on out because he has given us that coverage. I know you thought your insurance experience was good, but he said, I'm holding you in the palm of my hand. He said, I've got you covered. Yeah. You don't have to worry about it. He said, my Father gave it to me, and can't nobody pluck you out of my hand. You're talking about a good hand. I'm sure that's where all states got it from. Yeah. You in your hand. He's got you covered. There's nothing, no Samaria that you can hide in. There's no sin that you can commit. There's nothing that you can do that can separate you from the love of law of God. Can I tell you, you're covered from the top of your head to the sole of your feet. You're covered. You're covered when you mess up. You're covered when you're going out. You're covered when you're coming in. You got to get like that. God, I messed up. But if you can just restore me, I'll be what you are. He covers you so much. You can ask, how many times can I mess up, Lord? He said, 7 times 7. But that's just a basement. He covers you so much that he covers you even when you don't know that you're covered. He said, he got you covered all the way. Because you know what? He covered you so well. He said that Satan came into the world to destroy. He said, God said, but I send my son. He said, I send my son so that he could destroy the works of Satan. Can I tell you, not only do you need to know that you're empowered by choice, you need you empowered by coverage, but you're empowered by the commitment. One leper went back and committed to Christ. And all he said, thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen.
Worship him and praise him. And he said, blessed is the man that trusts in the Lord, whose hope is in the Lord. And you know, Paul said something that was so powerful when it came down to that Christian commitment. He said, you know, at the end of my life, he said, and I'm paraphrasing, he said, it's easy to die because I'm going to be with you, Lord. He said, sometimes it's harder to live, but I know I need to be here to help somebody. Y'all, we need to look at our lives differently. We need to look at our lives how God sent us here. If he wanted you to be holy and heavenly, he wouldn't have sent you to earth all your life. If he didn't want you to go through a trial and testimony, he would have left you up in heaven. He sent you here for a purpose. We forget that we're here for a purpose. You think this little short, a day with God is a 1,000 years. He's blinking his eye on us. Can I tell you, we don't understand our purpose. We're going to live, and we're going to live whole. It ain't about us. Right. It's about what he's called us to be. Right. It's about our assignment with God. He's given us a mission, and he's commissioned us to go forth. And so the good news of it is that, number one, you might have started out feeling a little hopeless today, but I just want you to know, God hadn't forgotten you, and he hasn't forsaken you. That you can rejoice, and you can rejoice because you have a living hope, a lively hope. You can rejoice because he wants you to live up to your expectation. He wants you to have high expectation. He wants you to be able to proclaim that I have this positive position. I have this hope, and to come what may from day to day. Y'all remember when Mahalia Jackson used to say, the only hope we have is all up there. It's in Christ Jesus. She said, it doesn't matter what the world brings, but I have this hope. So when I woke up this morning, I knew that each morning his verses were brand new. It didn't matter what I went through. I knew that there was nothing more than an event. Not only did he want you to be able to have that hope, he wanted you to endure the trials, but he wanted you to present your position, your petition to God in prayer. And so what he's done, he's just waiting on you. He's healed you. But don't you want to come back? Come on back to him. Don't you want to be whole? I sent you to the priest to get you certified, but I want you to take a moment. Come on back and get the whole thing. Because you got to know that you walk by faith and you're not by sight. When you get the wholeness, you don't have to see it. If you have a hope that you have to touch, feel, and smell, it ain't nobody's hope. It's like setting those low goals in your life. If you can obtain them every day, your goals are too low. You need to raise them up. You need to have that empowerment. You need to know that that's the Lord. And somebody loves you so much. And he loved you even in the midst when your hope looked like it was wavering. He loved you so much that God looked there. He said, I see that the hope is getting a little dried up down there. He said, I've given them the law and they couldn't handle the law. He said, but I have a more excellent way. Can I tell you that he sent his son Jesus through 42 generations? He wanted to change the dynamic. He wanted you to know that I'm sending my son. He's experienced what you experienced. He had gained comfort when he was on his way to the cross, when it was so painful to him. He said, Lord, not my will, but your will be done. It's that example that we we needed to know. There comes a point in our life that we got to know it's not about us. Mm-hmm. It's about the Christ that's in us.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
So can I tell you, he came on down. It's Jesus came through that 42 generation.
Right.
And he found you out in your Samaria. Wherever it is. Whatever's keeping you. Wherever you thought you were hiding. He knows where you are.
Yeah.
He knows where you what you're going through.
Yeah.
He knows what you've been through.
Yeah.
He knows that his grace is sufficient. He knows that he'll supply all your needs according to his riches and worth.
Yeah.
He knows that he wants you to have life and have it more abundantly.
Yeah.
So can I tell you, he came on down.
Yeah.
And he went through. You would have thought they would accept Jesus, the Son of God. But can I tell you, they rejected him. But that didn't stop the plan.
Yeah.
Because his plan was a plan of salvation.
Yeah.
A plan of grace and mercy.
Yeah.
And can I tell you, he went out. He said, now it's time. I'm going to show you what I can do with your hope. He said, I'm going to show you what I can do with your prayer. He said, it's trade-in time. He said, I want to heal the broken heart. Trade in that broken heart for healing. He said, I want to liberate the captives. You don't have to be in bondage no more. He said, I want to help the hand out some more. All of you that are hopeless, I want to give you hope. And then he said, I want to trade in that mourning. I want to comfort you. Can I tell you, everything you need, Christ has it.
Yeah.
And whatever you need, he told the woman at the well, you drink of this water, and you'll never thirst again. Now, we're not supposed to be running around here looking bad. We're not supposed to be running around here in bondage. We're not supposed to be running around not knowing what's going to happen. Because he wants to supply all you need. He said, trade in those ashes for a mourning. He said, trade them in for alls of joy. He said, he wants to heal you. But even after he went to the cross, he didn't stop there.
Come on now.
He said he went in the grave and he came out.
Yeah.
And can I tell you, every sin that you had, every problem that you had, all that non-living that you were doing,
come
he
on.
Nailed it to the cross.
Mm.
And can I tell you where he is now?
Come on.
I know you thought you didn't have no hope. But your lively hope, we serve a Christ, he lives, he lives. He lives, he lives. He lives, Because he's lived, he's sitting at the right hand of his Father. And for all of you that didn't quite make the mark, can I tell you, he's making a petition on you?
Yeah,
he's sitting at the right hand of the Father, making intercession. You know what that says to me? Fisher hadn't done all she should have. I know Fisher's gonna mess up a little bit. I know Fisher's gonna have some depressed days.
I know
Fisher's gonna have some sad days.
Yeah.
I know Fisher's gonna forget to pray sometimes, but you ought to be praying. I know Fisher's gonna feel like the world is against us. But I tell you, I have a Father, and he can lead me to you. And I tell you, my Holy Spirit. And when that Holy Spirit, that company of God is working in you, he said, I've taken care of you.
Yeah.
So my Father, on his right hand. So I just want to close by saying he hasn't forgotten you or forsaken you. He wants you to live, hold, and his plan of salvation is still working. So rejoice in hope, patient in tribulation, and don't forget to be.